Hello, welcome to day two of our virtual Spring Faire here at the Environmental Nature Center. My name is Miss Valerie. I have been here with the ENC for many years since I fell in love with this place way back when I started teaching summer nature camp. And I am going to tell you a few things about what we have going on. First things first, a big thank you to our Spring Faire sponsors, F&M Bank, Farmers and Merchants Bank. Thank you so much. And we have additional sponsors that we would like to thank very much. That would be Stephen Walsh Company. Thank you so much. Wesley Williams Group. The Dennerline family, hi Celeste. Flower Child Festival, hi Stacy, thank you so much. And a big thank you to the Janet Lee Crockman Company. Thank you so very much to all of these sponsors. All right. What do we have going next? This is a big thank you to all of our silent auction donors that we have. There may even be more by the time you're actually viewing this, so be sure to check out all the amazing auction items we have. Thank you so much to all of these donors that we have so far. Very much appreciated. What else do we have going on? Oh, so now that we talked about the donors, here's how you get to check out all their generous donations that they have and all these amazing prizes. You'll go here to the link that's provided. It will show you all the awesome things we have. To my tiny, mini, little naturalist families out there, you can bid on a day with me out here in nature. We'll get muddy and messy and have a picnic. Maybe we'll do the picnic first and the muddy play after. We'll figure that out. But I can't wait to see who bids on that. And maybe we can even offer more than one if it's super popular. I'm happy to do that for sure. So be sure to check all these things out. There's amazing children's books, all kinds of exciting things. Our nature preschool staff has offered some amazing things. So tiny, mini, little naturalists, check out what they have. You're going to be super interested in the stuff that the preschool staff has offered. Amazing. So many things. All right, there is that. And then we have, for all you Instagram folks out there, our Instagram contest. And what we want you to do is to decorate yourself in your best spring themed costume or face paint and post your photo on Instagram between May 11th and May 17th. So you still have time to do that. Be sure to tag it, hashtag 2020 ENC Spring Faire, for a chance to win awesome prizes. And there is extra credit if you include the hashtag support your nature center. And don't forget to follow us on Instagram for updates about that. So that's super exciting. I know many of you like to dress up and face paint and go for it. That would be super fun. Okay, on to today's schedule of events that we have going on today. All right, today's schedule of awesome virtual events. We have nature game time. Join us at home for Stump the Naturalist. Ooh. Super fun. I think they've been working really hard on that. We have an animal encounter happening today. Let's see who the animal of the day is. We have our Fire Circle stage performance from Brand New Tomorrow. And our Savor OC cooking show today is from Sessions West Coast Deli, how to make an awesome savory sandwich. So be sure to tune into that. And the last piece that I want to share with you is probably one of the most important that we're sharing. This is a way for us to thank the heroes during this time. So this pandemic has been challenging for all of us, but some members of our community have been thrust into the front lines of this public health crisis. Medical professionals, police officers, firefighters, grocery workers, package deliverers, and other essential workers have made untold sacrifices to get us through this. The ENC would like to shine a light on these heroes and give them something back in return. Nominate a frontline worker you know to receive their own private two-hour retreat here at the Nature Center, where they can enjoy the healing power of nature with their family. Nominate your frontline hero by sending a short 100-word or less description and photo to mark@encenter.org. The winning heroes will be announced at the end of the week on May 17th. that culminates in our virtual Spring Faire. So we'd love to hear about this from you. Please do that to all the essential workers out there. Thank you so much for everything that you've done and continue to do for us.
How scientific is it? Wait, you said in California?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, no.
Coral.
That's the fog in San Francisco. Is that your answer?
I thought it would be a trick question. Is that not
correct? It's not correct.
Great. You look as big as Mark.
Wow.
I'm just kidding.
I haven't been keeping track of your scores.
Oh, we are. We've been keeping track.
What is the oldest living tree in the world?
It's in the eastern Sierra Nevadas, and it goes like that. Something pine. No, bristlecone pine?
Yeah, bristlecone pine.
Bristlecone pine.
What is California state mineral?
Granite.
No.
Gold?
No. It's serpentine. Where is Uluru?
Australia.
Yeah.
That was a mess.
What is the gestation period of a blue whale?
17 months.
No.
12 months.
It is 12 months. How many times can a hummingbird flap its wings per second?
120.
Uh-uh. No. It's just 80.
80?
80.
That's not very impressive.
I only said 60.
California has 9 national parks. Name 5. Ooh. Costa Rica.
Okay. Yosemite. Channel Islands. There's 5 in California.
There's 9.
9 in California.
And you only have to name 5.
No, I don't know. Okay.
Yosemite, what else did you say? Yosemite, Joshua Tree, Death Valley, and Borrego?
Let's answer it together. Yosemite, Joshua Tree, Redwood National Forest? No, I think Redwood National Forest, and then the Channel Islands is a national park too.
Okay. Death Valley.
Death Valley. That's about 5.
Yeah, those are 5. Joshua Tree, Yosemite, Channel Islands, Kings Canyon, Redwood, Death Valley, Pinnacles, Lassen, and Point Reyes. What is the scientific name of an American bison?
We're stoned.
It's bison bison.
I knew it was a trick question. Should get half a point.
What is the name of the tallest tree in the world?
You're
a redwood.
What's its name?
What do you mean?
It has a name.
Okay, Mark, just tell us. Oh, yeah.
General Sherman.
It's not General Sherman.
It's Sherman? Big Sherman. It's not a general?
That's not the tallest tree.
Military rank? Oh, but there is a one. So
General Sherman is a tall tree, but it's not the tallest.
I think that counts as a half. Pass.
The answer is Hyperion. What is the most common way non-native species are introduced to new countries?
On the shoes of people. Or boats. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, go.
Boats.
I knew the boats.
Which bush gives the Sonoran Desert its classic scent, most notable after it rains?
George W. No, it's creosote.
Creosote. What does the Scoville heat unit scale measure?
Ooh, spiciness. Peppers?
Yeah, peppers. And the winner is Mark.
Stay tuned.
Hello everybody, my name is Sam. I'm a naturalist at the Environmental Nature Center. And I actually came to the Environmental Nature Center as an intern last December. So when I was studying at Saddleback College, I became really interested in outdoor education and science education. And I was looking for a place to volunteer at or intern at. And that's when I actually became aware of the Nature Center. And I looked into it and it really looked like a hidden gem to me. I had no idea about it. And I just thought, well, I need to be a part of this place. I'm really, really blown away by it. So I started interning back in December, spent some time working with other naturalists here. I was able to observe the field trips that we provided the Nature Center, some of the programs, and I just became more familiar with what science education is. And so when a naturalist position opened up, I decided to apply, and I was able to come on as an actual team member, which was really, really exciting for me. So today, as a naturalist, I'm going to go ahead and bring to you an animal encounter. So I want to introduce you to one of our animal ambassadors. This is Elliot. Now, Elliot is a tiger salamander. And I'm going to show you why Elliot has that name. So if you can see on Elliot's body, he's got stripes along him, quite similar to that of a tiger. So that's actually where his name comes from. Now Elliot has a kind of greenish brown face coloring and then a darker brown striping on him. And that's pretty typical for a tiger salamander. Their color might vary a bit. They might be more green on the base, and then sometimes they actually do have yellow or darker brown spots or splotches along their body as a pattern. And Elliot's also fairly average size for a tiger salamander. So an average size for a tiger salamander is anywhere from 6 to 8 inches, although they can reach up to 14 inches, with the largest salamander recorded being, well, the largest tiger salamander recorded being 13 inches. So that's just over 13 or a foot long, which is pretty big if you think about it. So I actually want to also show you Elliot's face, bring your attention to another part of Elliot. So aside from being really cute, you can see that he has a kind of broad face, kind of flat in the front. And that actually helps him when he's creating his home. So in the wild, if Elliot was there, other tiger salamanders actually live in forest. Usually they're found under tree stumps, maybe under some rocks. And underneath those things, you would find them in burrows. So basically, Elliot would use his arms and his legs and his face to dig into the ground and create a little tunnel, a little burrow, about 2 feet from the surface. And that's actually where he spends a majority of his time. They live a majority of the time underground. Now they do come up to the surface. One of the times they come up is at night when they are looking for food, when they're hunting for food. So tiger salamander would come up in the evening and they would look for something to eat. And they would eat worms or other insects like crickets. You know, Elliot likes to eat crickets. But a wild salamander, a wild tiger salamander might also eat a frog, a small mouse, or even a smaller salamander. So really kind of anything that they can get their mouth around. And another time that a tiger salamander would come up out of their burrow is during the springtime. So during the springtime, that would be when they would reproduce. So once the snow has melted or after there's been a big rain, there's a lot of puddles around. And so the tiger salamanders would come to the top and they'd look for a puddle that they might go into, or even a shallow pond or slow moving stream. And they'd spend some time there. And in that time in the pond, there'd be other tiger salamanders also spending some time there. And that's when they would actually lay their eggs. So Elliot and other tiger salamanders are actually amphibians. So that means that they spend part of their life in the water and then part of their life on land. And another characteristic of these tiger salamanders and other amphibians is that they go through a metamorphosis in their life. So that means that they'll go through a transformation to journey into adulthood. So like I said, when those tiger salamanders are in that little body of water and they're laying their eggs, that begins their metamorphosis. So that would be the first stage in their metamorphosis. So they would last as eggs in that little body of water anywhere from 19 to 50 days. And at that time, they would emerge as larvae. So they'd emerge from those eggs and they'd look sort of similar to tadpoles. They would have gills. So if you can imagine Elliot, have little gills in this area, and they'd be swimming around in those little bodies of water, those little puddles, and they would last as larvae for anywhere from 2.5 to 5 months, at which time they're going through that transformation, that metamorphosis, and they're turning into adults. So they'd reach adulthood in that time frame. And then, once they've reached adulthood, they would crawl back out of those ponds, those little bodies of water, and they would go create another home underground, just like other tiger adult salamanders. And they would live the rest of their life. And they actually have a pretty long lifespan as well. So, tiger salamanders in the wild can live up to 10 years. So that's a pretty long time. And if they're in captivity, like Elliot here, which means they're being taken care of by humans, they can last even longer. They can have a lifespan of 25 years. So that's also a really long time. Now, of course, there's a few things that might affect how long a tiger salamander lives. One thing that might affect their lifespan is loss of habitat. So tiger salamanders in California are actually endangered due to loss of habitat. And another thing that might affect tiger salamanders is pollution. Now, we might wonder, why would pollution affect Elliot or other tiger salamanders in the wild? Well, I want to bring our attention back to Elliot's skin. So you can see he looks kind of shiny, right? Maybe a little wet. And that's actually because he is wet. So Elliot has really thin skin and he's actually able to breathe through his skin. And he's also able to drink water through his skin. So you might think, well, if there's pollution and that's how he's taking in his water, what if he's drinking some polluted water or the air quality isn't that great? That might affect a tiger salamander. And for that reason, tiger salamanders are actually known as bioindicator species, which means that they're a species, an animal that is monitored by scientists, because it gives them clues about things. So if a scientist notices that tiger salamanders might not have as many numbers as they did before, that may give them an idea that there might not be good air quality or good water quality. So they're very important in that way. So I hope you've gotten a chance to get to know Elliot, get to know a little bit more about other tiger salamanders, and I hope you've enjoyed today's video.
Thank you.
Thomas, and joining me today will be Max Schlutz, Culinary Director and Partner at Sessions West Coast Delis in both Newport Beach and Huntington Beach. And I feel like I won the lotto because he's going to share the secrets of his fabulous Summer Zephyr sandwich. I'm so excited because I love this sandwich, and it's really kind of like a caprese salad on a bun, but better.
Thank you, Kathy. It's exactly like a caprese salad sandwich, but we do it a little differently. We make sure that every single component has a life of its own. And so we marinate it, we brine it, so you get the right texture, taste. First thing we're gonna do is make a vinegar base. All equal parts, rice wine vinegar, cider vinegar, water, and sugar. Bring it to a boil. As soon as you see that boil, you kill it and you're ready to go.
You can do this in advance.
Absolutely, and the shelf life is that of a vinegar.
So it's a rapid boil, off it goes.
You can either cool it, which we're going to do when we marinate our tomatoes. Mm-hmm. But first, what we're gonna do is pickle some onions, and I use a red onion here. I like the color and I like the sweetness. These onions will pickle almost instantaneously, but you can keep them in the brine when you store them.
And how long can I store these in the fridge?
You're good for a week. Let's go tomatoes.
All right.
When you think of a caprese salad or a caprese sandwich, mozzarella, yes, but also the tomato. The tomato is so vital. It's acting not only as a condiment to the mozzarella, but it's very steaky. There's a great texture to it. Mm-hmm. And it's such a bright, impactful flavor. Our chilled vinegar base, a little bit of olive oil, 1 or 2 teaspoons of salt to give it that caprese vibe. We're gonna chiffonade some basil. And then I'm just gonna stir it up a little bit to incorporate the vinegar base and the oil and the salt.
So you've kind of got an herbaceous vinaigrette.
It's exactly like that. You can use Roma tomatoes, you can use heirloom tomatoes, you can use beefsteak tomatoes, you can use whatever you like. So I've got some Romas here. So I'm gonna slice into about 1/4 inch thick. Drop it in.
And how long do you want that to marinate?
In a perfect world, overnight I think is best. As little as 2 hours. They will keep, you get about 4 days out of it. I think anything longer than that, the tomato starts to break down, and you probably eat them all within that time anyway, because they're so delicious.
Yeah.
Basil aioli. I like to give it a little head start.
Got it.
Smash it up a little bit, and literally throw in some basil, throw in the mayonnaise. I'm gonna pulse it about 4 times, okay?
All right.
I'm probably gonna let it go for 20 seconds.
To talk about the bread.
We're making a sandwich, so the bread is vital. Mm-hmm. If you live in Orange County and you own a restaurant, you get your bread from one place.
And where is that?
It's Dean's OC Baking.
Yeah.
What he's done for us is he made a fantastic French roll, which with this sandwich is really good because it's not super dense, and I toast it closed so that the inside is soft, the outside is where your texture comes from. No need for a pan, just throw it right on the grate.
Okay.
Final component is a little bit of arugula. Here it's fantastic because it's peppery and it's bright. You know, the texture holds up, you get crunch out of it.
So the arugula gets dressed with some olive oil?
Just a little bit of olive oil. And the last thing I do with all of my salads is a little bit of salt on the greens. I think I do it before I dress it with dressings. I think it just brightens it up and it makes the dressing pop. And we're gonna build.
All right, let's all right? build it.
Let's have some fun. The beautiful French roll.
Mm-hmm.
You hear that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Basil aioli, I do it on both sides. Fresh mozzarella, I layer about 4. I do the cheese first because the tomatoes have, you know, quite a bit of moisture in them, and I think it helps protect the bread. As much as I want the bread to soak in all the great flavors, tomatoes aren't great year-round, but these marinated tomatoes are great year-round.
Right. Here come the onions.
Okay, now this is the bright factor that we were talking about. Mm-hmm. This is what cuts through the fattiness of the aioli, the cheese. Mm-hmm. It marries perfectly with tomato, which have just, this, again, the same little acidity. Our arugula, I go high. I go big with it.
You know, I like that.
All right? Instead of doing a balsamic vinaigrette, we take a balsamic reduction. And I'd like to introduce you to my girlfriend.
Yes.
The Summer Zephyr.
Whether you're a vegetarian or a carnivore.
Yep.
This is the sandwich.
It's totally the sandwich.
Thank you, Max.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it.
I had a great time.